Good morning, everybody. This is a new colloquia organized by the Instituto de Astrofísica de Andalucía in Granada. And today we have Dr. Noemi Pinilla-Alonso from UCF in Florida, United States. And she will talk about the Arecibo Observatory and a facility of the National Science Foundation. Isabel Marquez, our scientific director, will introduce Noemi. Isabel.
Hello, good morning. Thank you, everybody, for coming to this web colloquia from the Observatory program at the IAA. And welcome, of course, Noemi Pinilla-Alonso. Dr. Noemi Pinilla-Alonso is science manager at the Arecibo Observatory since 2018. She got her PhD at the University of La Laguna in Tenerife, Spain, in 2009. And then she got postdocs first at the Department of Earth and Planetary Science in the University of Tennessee in the United States, then at the IAA here with us in the Instituto de Astrofísica de Andalucía in Granada, and then the NASA Ames Research Center in Moffett Field, California. In 2015, she joined the Florida Space Institute, the FSI, as an associate scientist. She has co-authored more than 50 papers in refereed international publications and more than 100 contributions in international meetings, a number of them as invited talks. As a planetary scientist, her research focuses on discovering how our solar system formed and evolved to its present state, in particular through the analysis of the surface composition of minor bodies in terms of surface alteration mechanisms and formation conditions. She combines modeling and observational techniques, including observations from the ground with using Gemini, GTC, and IRTF, or from spacecrafts like Deep Impact and Gaia, or data from space telescopes, mainly Herschel or Spitzer. In fact, in the last years, she has been studying with ARAC Spitzer data for more than 150 minor bodies for a comprehensive and systematic study of the surface composition, combining observations from the visible to the mid-infrared, which are optimal to study the distribution of silicate material, complex organics, volatiles, and ices in the solar system. Dr. Pinilla-Alonso has also led the project preparing for James Webb Space Telescope completing the ARAC legacy in the Kuiper Belt. James Webb will enable us to characterize in detail and for the first time the composition of a large sample of ancient objects orbiting the sun in the coldest regions of the solar system, the trans-Neptunian belt. Today, Dr. Noemi Pinilla-Alonso will talk about the Arecibo Observatory roadmap for the future, science enhancement plans under the UCF management. Thank you very much, Noemi, for accepting our invitation, and welcome to the IAA.
Thank you very much, Isabel, for such a detailed introduction, and thank you, René, for the invitation and everything. And thank you, all of you, for being here to chat a little bit about the plans and the present of the Arecibo Observatory. We were talking before how difficult it is to give this kind of colloquium in remote virtually because you don't have interaction with the people. So if Isabel and René allow me, I would like to ask you to, the talk is going to have different sections. We are going to talk a little bit about management and about the three different science areas that we cover. Then if you have some questions at some point, I was thinking maybe you can throw them in the chat and then instead of waiting at the end, but this depends on Isabel and René, what they want. So let me go there. Let me tell you a little bit. I'm pretty sure you all have heard about the Arecibo Observatory because, you know, it's in the Contact movie. So we all know about it. But I wanted to present it to you as the great facility and the great scientific site that it is to perform cutting-edge research. And in a lot of different areas, and with the best instrumentation that you can imagine for what you need to do there. So this photo here shows a little bit of the antenna that is the big asset here, the one that gives all the sensitivity to it. With Arecibo and with some other installations that we have on site, we cover a lot of areas of radio astronomy, of space and atmospheric science, and of planetary science. And we also do a pretty extensive job in education and public outreach. So from 2017, of course, it has been working since 1963. So not all of it is because of us. But since 2017, with UCF, University of Central Florida, has been managing the Arecibo Observatory. So I will show you in the next slide how it is organized, but mainly it's three different units: the University of Central Florida for all the science content, Young Enterprise for all the operations of the observatory, and Universidad Ana Gemende that is responsible for all the EPO projects, the education and public outreach. So basically, this large facility runs on a budget of about 11 million a year. And where does this money come from? So in the National Science Foundation, we have a cooperative agreement with them from 2017 to 2023, for 5 years. And it's 7 million what they provide a year. Then there is an award that one of our PIs won in one of the open calls from NASA. That is the one that covers planetary defense. And this covers another 4 million a year. So also, there are some additional funds that we have been able to secure these years. So there is about 13 million that NSF provided us also for repairs after Maria hurricane that came in 2017. So when we took this, there were a lot of repairs to do because of that. And so that's a big project that some of the updates that I'm going to talk run on this budget, and some of the others come from other sources. Then UCF provides additional funds, about $600,000 up to early 2020, but it keeps going. And it's basically for one of the facilities that we have in Isla Culebra. You will hear about it later. Also, we have been able to start a program of pay to observe when researchers or institutes or projects that want to secure time at Arecibo, they pay for that slice of the time of Arecibo. And there is a whole webpage where you can go there and check, because depending on the experiment that you want to run, the price is going to be different. So we are starting to collect money through this source. And also we have secured and spent already $200,000 that the Universidad Ana Gemende has been for infrastructure. So we, in this year, we have used it to improve the office building. There's like four floors of offices that we have there, and also the cafeteria that was in not very needed update. I mean, and it was a continuous theme of conversation during that. So that was something that we have been able to do in this 2020. So also probably, because I've seen that there are some Arecibo friends in the audience here, you probably know that even if the situation now is 7-4 from NSF, this is not what came in the cooperative agreement that we signed. NSF has been progressively, since years ago, cutting the budget to Arecibo and to other facilities. So what you see here in the graph on the right, the blue columns is what we have signed with NSF. Then the yellow is what we have been awarded through NASA. And the orange is the additional funds that we have been able to secure with NSF year by year. This we negotiate with them every year. So there is still some mismatch here for next year, for the last 2 years of the contract, but those are things that we are continuously negotiating with NSF. So how are we organized? there is an office that is represented here on the top, that is the office of the PI. So these people were the ones that participated in the funding proposal that's submitted to NSF. Ray Lugo is the main PI, that is the director of the Florida Space Institute where I work. And then Jan is a co-PI in representation of the Young Enterprise, the one responsible for operations. And UAGM, Universidad Ana Geméndez, is Carlos Padín, that was the co-PI. And then the Office of the Principal Scientist that is run by Jan and by me. And we, our duties are mainly advocate for Arecibo and be sure that that we open more collaborations and more contacts with the community. And that's one of the reasons I'm here. The on-site director and the one that really runs the business, if you need something, go to Francisco. He's Francisco Córdoba. So he's an engineer and he's the one that that is really updated with everything that is passing on the three fronts, like EPO, operations, and science, and the one that brings those desires and those commands to the people working on site. So on site in Arecibo, there is a position called here science manager that I've been running through November 2018, but this is an open position now. So if anyone is interested, and I think it's out as deputy science director or something like that. So basically it's the person that is in charge of all the, and manages all the science group. The science group is divided in three areas: planetary radar that has 7 people, space and atmospheric sciences that has 7 people, plus one that we are hiring now is a postdoc. And then the astronomy group that is run by Anis, and is 6 people, and one new scientist for VLBA that is hired, but we are waiting for her to be able to secure an interview to get the visa and really come on site and start working with us. So with this COVID situation, everything has been stopped and we have been waiting for this like 9 months almost. Then Jaime Gago, that is the director of operations. He runs all the infrastructure from the cafeteria to IT, so all the software, the hardware, or everything there. Platform, receivers, antenna, everything. It's 100 people that works to secure that these about 20 scientists are able to do their job. And then EPO, Carlos Padín, with a group on communications and the ones that are the contents. If you want to do a visit there, they run the visitor center, they run the visits that come there to record, like National Geographic, they're doing one now, or these kind of things. So, what else? And this is the site. It's a little bit complicated, so let me walk you through this. Of course, you have the big antenna here. That's more than 300 meters of antenna. And where is all the people? So you have here all where the operations are run. These are hardware stores and the HF facility that we will talk later is also based here. Then this is a pool. We have a pool there and the cafeteria where we have lunch every day. Then there are some cabins here, some lodging facilities here. This is the business, the building with the floor plants dedicated to science and library also, and the meeting rooms, everything is there. Then this is a lab, several labs. And also where the room for the operations, the observing room is. So here you have a big, big window and the telescope operators that are sitting there, they have a big window where they can really see the telescope because you know this is a radio telescope. It works day and it works night, not only at night. And this is important, on top of this big antenna that is the primary mirror, there is this structure here that you can see, this triangle, that is what we call the platform. And is where the secondary, that is this dome that is here, is hanging from this arch. And you can see it very good in this shadow that is here. You have the platform, you have this ring where the arch is able to rotate, and you have here the secondary. And this is so that we can really focus all the information that is received from the primary. So also there are, I didn't go through this, but there are some labs here on the top of this cliff. There are some labs that are for optical observations. Let's go to the next. If you have any questions, you just throw it in the chat and Renee and Isabel can communicate them to me. So this is another view of the antenna, but this is from below it. This is the original antenna that was a chicken net. It was not a very sophisticated thing. You don't need a very polished mirror with a lot of reflectance material and everything. With a net, it is good enough so that you reflect everything. But it was improved later for more sensitivity and everything. And you can see here on the right that is formed by these panels that are 1 meter per 2 meters. And there are about 40,000 aluminum panels. So they form a spherical surface, and that is the primary surface of this Arecibo telescope. But I said aluminum panels, but they are not like a table. Don't imagine it at all like that. This is the view that you can have of the platform and of the dome that stores the secondary and the tertiary, and of the arch. And this is how you can see it from below. So these panels are made of aluminium, but they are not solid and filled. So this is another view. So have the platform again, this triangle that is here with the circle, the arch, and the dome. So it weighs 900 tons, and it's hanging there from 18 cables. You can see some of them here in this picture, that go to three pillars, like this one that is on the back, and is just hanging there at 150 meter high. So this is more or less the height of the Torre Picasso in Madrid or Torre España. And that is where this is respect to the platform. So the secondary is stored inside this dome. There is a hole here where all the light is collected, and it's 27 meters, and there is also a tertiary there. And there is a room that is inside here that has several receivers. So all the information is then sent through this. This is the walkcat. You will see a photo later, but this is where you have to walk if you want to go to the platform. But there is also this optic fiber that takes all the information to the operations that would be here on the left of the image. So let's go to the next. Some numbers here. Wait one moment, because I think before the numbers I had some more pictures. Yeah, let me go through the pictures and let me put the numbers at the end. So I'm going to show you just some more pictures so that you see everything and you figure out the dimensions of everything. This that is in the back here, this is the visitor center where it's a three floors building, and there we have movies and we have visits and exhibition, everything. The operations room is not very visible, it's here in the back. So there is a cliff here, and inside there is all the buildings for the operations, labs, and everything. Then go to the next. This is the walkcat that I was telling you, where you have to walk to go to the platform. Some people is scared, some people is not. I really enjoy it. So this is again the view from the bottom. And this is the view from inside the dome. So these that you can see below are the panels. This is the antenna. And this here is the dome with the secondary. And then a room in the back for all the receivers. And this is below the antenna. It's not on the floor. There is a lot of space there. You can see all these cables, all these tie downs, because all these panels can be adjusted one by one to improve, like with active optics, to improve the reflectance of the surface and to improve the accuracy of the pointing and of the gain of the telescope and everything. So these panels here are 1 by 2 meters, so you can figure out the height that is really the space below the antenna. Well, so now some numbers, because you are observers. So the frequency range that the Arecibo telescope covers goes from 300 megahertz to 10 gigahertz. And this goes in lambda from 3 centimeters to 1 meter. So it has pointing limits. This is a very sensitive antenna because it's very big, but it's fixed there. So you only can see what is in your field of view. There is some capability to point, but very limited. So you cover basically from about 20 degrees in zenith angle. And for declination, that means that you go from 1 degree 20 minutes to 38 degrees 02 minutes only. The pointing accuracy is 5 seconds. The surface is aligned up to 0.25 centimeters, and this really affects the gain. I mean, has a lot of influence in the gain. So one of the projects for this year was to realign the surface to improve the gain. And then it can SLU, it can track objects, and this means that it can go at rates of 24 degrees per minute. So this is my description of the telescope. If you have any questions, you can do it now. I'm going to switch now a little bit to describe the research areas and the research history of Arecibo. So I will go in more detail later because I'm going to go through each of them. But as I mentioned, there are 3 areas that can work totally independent at Arecibo, but that also have some points in common where we can grow synergies. So space and atmospheric science, we study all the atmosphere with different kinds of instrumentation, and we go up to the top of to the ionosphere. So then, for example, for synergy, we have with radio astronomy, we study all the kind of exotic objects there, like pulsars, galaxies, gravitational waves, everything. But we also can observe these objects to study the solar flares, the flares from our own sun, and that totally grows synergies with how it affects the ionosphere, and also the planetary group is very focused in planetary defense, so in observing and tracking near-Earth objects. But we can also study comets. And to study the comets, we do them with spectroscopy that is run actually now by one of our members of the radio astronomy group. So these 3 groups that used to work totally independently before we arrived to Arecibo, they are now working together and growing synergies. What happened before? So Arecibo has 55 years of science, really very successful, and most of these things can still be done at Arecibo. So for example, the first success, we would say that in 1963, Arecibo did the best determination of the rotation rate of Mercury. So the rotational period was estimated to be 88 days before Arecibo observed it, and it was reduced to 59 days, thanks to observations with Arecibo telescope. In 1974, the first pulsar in a binary system was discovered, and this led to a Nobel Prize in 1993. In 1981, we did the first radar of the surface of Venus. And this is a very nice thing, because you know that Venus has this thick atmosphere that the surface can only be observed with a radar. So Arecibo is in the very best position to do that until Bepi Colombo arrives there. But this is something that we can always do, and we can do in support of these kind of missions. So also the discovery of the first millisecond pulsar in 1982 happened. The first planets outside the solar system were discovered in 1992, the first planet with the Arecibo Observatory. In 1998, when the SOHO spacecraft lost communication with the base on Earth, with the operations room here, we found the satellite and we were able to establish the connection again to tell them where it was. So we can also support human exploration in that sense. Which is this? Ah, yeah. The first near Earth asteroid in a binary system was discovered with Arecibo in 2000. The discovery of the first triple asteroid system also was done in Arecibo. And also in 2018, Arecibo discovered the first ever repeating fast radio burst. I want to always to go through this, because it really shows the diversity of works that can be done at Arecibo, and also shows how successful it has been since the very beginning in 1963 to 2018. And this has been, we are always trying to update and to do new things in Arecibo, but even with the old things, we have been very successful. It's just that we want to push forward and to go further, you know? So now let's go with the actual highlights. What are we doing now at Arecibo? Our main idea in the office at UCF when we arrived to Arecibo is that, based on the knowledge that we had on Arecibo, Arecibo for a long time had been working, doing a great job in support of other scientists. It was a serving institution in the sense that in the last years, at least, most of the scientists at Arecibo worked to support observations of others. And they had been slowing down in their own science, in leading their own projects. Ray, as the director of a research space institute in Florida, and myself and Jan as active researchers, we had in mind that it was very important that if we wanted to make Arecibo shine again, and we wanted to make it really important for NSF to keep funding it, so that we could go to the different funding agencies and tell them, look, this is how good Arecibo can do. We need you to keep supporting us. So if we wanted to do that, we needed to show how much it could do, and our scientists that are real experts on each of the areas that they work could help us to do that. So this is what we have been doing in the last 2 years, and this is how we are succeeding in this. The Planetary Science Group is a small group, but it's very powerful, because they are really committed to work in collaboration with the Planetary Defense Coordination Office of the NASA, of the United States. And this is a very important piece for NASA and for the Congress here at the US. So there are several calls for soft money funds where we can go and we can tell them to support our work. So the motivation of this group is to follow the congressional mandate to detect, track, and characterize all the large asteroids that exist in the solar system that are around 100 kilometers large. So we really want to cover that range up to 140 meters. And this is fully supported by NASA. So, as you know, with radar, you don't search the sky to discover things. You really have to target your targets to extract information from them. So we work in collaboration with the different surveys that are done in the optical that really discover this. As soon as they discover, we receive notification and we update our list of observations for this month. So with the telescope, the good thing is that we can observe night and we can observe day. So when telescope that discover have to stop tracking the object to determine the orbit, we can go there and we can keep tracking it so that we cover a largest arc on its orbit and we can really refine and see which is the real orbit of this small asteroids. That most of the times, the ones that we are interested are those ones that are going to do close passes close approaches to the Earth. So this is what we call post-discovery tracking and characterization. And we do about 100 near-Earth asteroids a year, a handful of main-belt asteroids and some comets, depending on how bright they are. And occasionally, we observe also terrestrial planets and the moon. So those are typically short programs that we run every year. We dedicate a couple of days to Venus, a couple of days to Mercury, these kind of things. Then, we can, the radial velocity resolution, we can determine the velocity of these asteroids up to a few millimeters per second. And one very good characteristic of the observations that we do is that they are not only good to determine the orbit, they are also good to study the surface of these asteroids, because using polarimetry, we can characterize the different sized particles on the surface. And another thing that is good to work in collaboration is that you can study the scattering properties of the surface of an asteroid with optical and near infrared observations also. But that covers a different layer on the surface of the asteroid than the one that we can cover with radar. And that also happens for the moon, and that also happens for the planets. So collaborations between optical observations and radar observations are really interesting to do this kind of studies of the particles on the regolith on the surface of the small bodies in the solar system. This is a plot that shows the progress of the radar group in Arecibo since 1998 to 2018. So what we have here is in red the PHAs, that are the potential hazard asteroids, in blue the near Earth asteroids, and in gray the ones that we attempt and we don't cover. So you can see what a difference it did in 2012 to start working really close in collaboration with the Planetary Defense Office. But you can also see, you know, 2017 was not so good compared with the ones before because of the impact of Maria, that for some months Arecibo Telescope Observatory was closed. But then 2018, we started recovering from that, and 2019, that is the last column here, was a total success and did a record in the detection of post-discovery detection and tracking of near-Earth asteroids. So we attempted 163 and we succeeded in 75% of them. And we also did observations on one comet and of one planet, of Mercury. And this was done with about 600 hours of observations around the year. So for those that are interested in asteroids, let me walk you through these highlights from 2019. These are three different kinds of objects here. The one that is on the left, on the top, is 2002 QF15. This was a PHA, a potential hazard asteroid, and this had been observed before, like four times, but when we observed it in 2019, it was the closest approach of all of these. So we could really study well the surface characteristics, the shape, and the size. We know that is 1600 meters in size. We know that it has a rotational period around its own axis of 32 hours. And this was determined with radar observations, and it comes that is 68% smaller than what was determined with this rotational light curves in the visible. And this is probably because these rotational light curves were not complete. You see if it's 32 hours of rotation, you really have to observe a lot of, do a very long chain of observations on different days to cover that rotational period. Or you have to observe with different telescopes all around the globe to be able to cover 24 hours, 32 hours. So the fact that we can do longer chains of observations, observing day and night, it was did our work, our determination more accurate. Then we have here, well, also, sorry, with these observations of the surface, we can have a broad estimations of the visible albedo, that is the amount of light that this object reflects. And it comes, is about 20%, what is tells us that is not a primitive asteroid. The ones that have more complex organics on the surface, like Ryugu and Bennu, because those have a lower albedo below, let's say, 6-7%. Okay, then the other update that I have here or highlight is 2019 OK. This was another near-Earth asteroid that was discovered by Sonar. It's one of these surveys in the visible that are scanning the sky very frequently. So just 24 hours after the discovery, we were able to point to it from Arecibo and to observe it. We did a pretty good determination of the size. It's a small one, so it's less than 130 meters in size. And the good thing, the big thing that we did for the community with the observations of this near-Earth asteroid was that the determination of the orbit that we did says that when it approaches the Earth next time, that is 2035, is going to be 4 times closer to the Earth than it was predicted before. So, and the good thing also is that our when we really go so deep in, so precise in determining the orbit of these asteroids, what it assures us that we are going to be able to recover and to reobserve this object when it approaches again. These objects, typically, they shrink by the sun and they are bright only for some, maybe some weeks, and then they go fainter and they get lost unless you have a very good orbit determined. So that was what happened with 2019, okay. And this one that you have here, and it's not really one, is this ones, because what we discovered is that it's a binary system. This is 2020 BX12, and it's a potential hazard asteroid. So you can see here the main component is on the bottom, and the secondary is here on the top. So the primary is about, is basically round, and it's about 165 meters. The satellite is 70 meters, so a little bit less than half of the primary. And they are pretty separated, is 360 meters, the separation. And one good thing of our observations of this target is that we discovered that the rotational period is around 50 hours, but also the mutual orbital period is about 50 hours. So this means that they are probably tidally locked. This is a system that has been together so long that this has been able to lock tidally and to spin in that way. So now let me show you a couple of, just before I finish with Planetary, a couple more highlights. The one that you see here on the left, this was not led by people at Arecibo, but it was done based on Arecibo data and also together with data from Cassini. So this shows very well how we can work together with missions, with NASA or ESA missions. So from long time ago, observations of Arecibo had seen very bright spots on the poles of Titan and on the surface of Titan, and it was not understood where did this come from. For a long time, for more than a decade, we knew of them, but we didn't know where this came from. So basically, reanalysis of some observations of the Cassini mission of Titan were able to discover that these are paleo lakes they are called. And this means that these are lakes that were dried long time ago, ancient lakes. So we are seeing the basin of these lakes. So the composition that is there is different from the other because it has been really affected by this interaction, interface between the lake and the surface, the solid surface of the of Titan. So this was a cool paper published in 2020, but also this is a paper that has been submitted, and this is one of these points of collaboration between our groups at Arecibo. So when Comet Neowise was discovered this year, all the optical telescopes have been observing it, and we have proved because the Division for Planetary Science conference was last week, and there was a whole session dedicated to this comet. But not only the optical telescopes, our radio astronomy group jumped also to the operations room. They asked for director time, and they did spectroscopy of this comet at 18 centimeters. This is a very good frequency range because there you can observe the OH emission and you can estimate the sublimation rates on this comet. Unfortunately, we have a hiccup at the observatory that I will tell later, and the observatory is not operational anymore, so all the follow-up observations that they had planned for August, this was done at the end of July, we couldn't do them, so all our results are based on one only observation. But it's a good, very good observation that shows, you can see here that this line that is in the spectrum is not a single peak one, it has contribution from different bands of oxygen there. And it also allows us to study one phenomenon that is called quenching, that happens when the molecules interact with the comet, with the dust and everything in the on this comet that was actually very, very active. So this is one program that we want to run at Arecibo with our people now, like to systematically observe all the comets that approach close enough so that they can be reached with Arecibo. And as a resume for the future of the planetary science at Arecibo, and this is where some of you may be interested in collaborating with us and or maybe even in submitting proposals. We work on open calls every 6 months. So we will continue with the observations of the near Earth objects or asteroids in collaboration with the Planetary Defense Office because that's our main goal. But also we want to extend the characterization to the targets that we observe with radar. We want to extend it to the visible and near infrared. We are doing that now in collaboration with the Instituto Astrofísico de Canarias, but we may do it also in collaboration with you guys at the Instituto Astrofísico de Andalucía or even using the Observatorio Sierra Nevada. And we have now one of the new people that we have hired at Arecibo is an optical and near infrared observer. So with this guy, and we can establish this close collaboration with the group, radar group, to do follow-up observations of the interesting targets. We also are interested in extending the studies of the surface of asteroids to the surface of the moon, and to do these polarimetric observations. We have two guys now specialized on that at the Arecibo Observatory. So this may be of interest for the teams that are interested in the human exploration of the moon and in situ research utilization, for example. Then we are also interested in supporting NASA and ESA missions. We have done that with the OSIRIS-REx in a very good determination of the shape of Bennu prior to the arrival of the mission. We are doing that with Dark Era also because we will be able to observe the target after the impact. So we will be able to determine the orbit and see if it has been really affected by the impact or not. But also we are able to support exploration of Mars, Mercury and Venus and Venus, and we are interested in that. And we are going to continue to pay attention to do comet spectroscopy and also coma studies that I will describe later. We can study the plasma tail, not coma, sorry, the plasma tail of the comet thanks to one technique that is called interplanetary scintillations. We have done it for Borisov, is some work on their analysis, but we can do it for other comets also. Another space for development for the future of the planetary science at Arecibo is through our collaboration with the group based at the University of Central Florida. So at the University of Central Florida, there is a virtual research institute funded by NASA that is called the Center for Lunar and Asteroid Surface Sciences, CLASS. And so this is really interested on, it has a component because this is an international institute that has researchers all over the world, but then it has a component that is very interested in in situ research utilization. And there is a lab that they are building soils so that you can use to reproduce the surface of the asteroids or the surface of the moon with different compositions, different sizes of the regolith, everything. And then you can, we also sell it online and everything. So if you have a lab and you want to do studies of the reflectance of these materials and you want to compact them and break them or whatever, that's something that we are doing. But the component that is of use for Arecibo is that we are we are developing, we are trying to put together a competition, robotics competition. And we want to do that in Puerto Rico. And we want to reproduce there the surface of an asteroid. And for some days or some months, having teams of high school students or undergrad students that build robots that are able to do specific tasks that we think are needed if we go and try to exploit the surface of the moon. So for example, there is another component of the class is a group for landed platform studies. So we have done research that tells us that the regolith on the surface of the moon is so loose that if you start landing there, you're going to, and you try to land very big rockets, you're going to throw a lot of dust into orbit around the moon that is going to impact other experiments that are around. So it's very important for the utilization of the moon and for the exploration of the moon that we are able to build landing platforms. And to build these platforms, we have to push rocks. So one particular task that these rocks are going to have to do is to be able to push the boulders on the surface of the moon so that we have an area that is flat enough so that we can build a landing platform. And this kind of competitions, we want to do them at Puerto Rico. I did this already. And now, if you have any question about planetary science, then I can go to radio astronomy. What do you think, René? Go ahead or do we wait for some questions?
There is no question, so you can go ahead.
Okay.
Also, go ahead. In the chat, there is no other questions, so let's go and at the end, all the questions can be asked.
Okay, perfect. So let's go ahead with radio astronomy for groundbreaking discoveries. This is, I have to tell you, I'm an astrophysicist from studies, but for my master, I did the site characterization, studying the atmosphere and the transparency of the atmosphere. And then I switched to planetary science. So all the radio astronomy is in the back of my head and I've been trying to rescue it in the last 3 years. I'm pulling threads there to really get to understand everything that we're able to do, because what Arecibo can do for radio astronomy is amazing. And I know at the Instituto Astrofísico de Andalucía, there is a lot of good astrophysics going on and even very good radio astronomers. So probably you know of these things better than I do. So forgive me if I say something that is not totally correct, but let me walk you through the different things that our team at Arecibo, and all of these that I put here are at this moment at some end led by our people, our staff. We had some problems when we started running Arecibo because the radio astronomy group, because of different personal and professional reasons, they decided to leave Puerto Rico. So when I arrived in November 2018 to Puerto Rico, the radio astronomy group was formed by two people only, and these were two first-year postdocs. So you can imagine the work that we have been doing this in the last year and a half to staff that group. If you remember when I showed it in the other slide, we have now six people in the group. There are two senior researchers, one junior researcher, two postdocs, one science operation, that is more like a data analyst, is a recent graduate from Bachelor. And then the VLBI person, Aleta, that is coming, we don't know when, depends on COVID, but so all of this has been happening since September 2018. And at this point, we have already people there, a really competitive science group that is going beyond their duties, and they are leading very cool science projects. For example, one of them that is of interest of Anis mainly is the Anis and Alison Smith, is the to study how the molecular clouds form. And for that, you can use the 21 centimeters H1 line and all the carbon recombination lines that can be observed from Arecibo. But also, they do a lot of studies of these carbon recombination lines towards extragalactic sources, and they do this at low frequencies below 1 GHz. That is the, yeah, we have a couple of receivers there. Then there are also studies of the diffuse interstellar medium, and they do that with large-scale deep searches for small infalling molecular clouds at high latitudes. That is the specific description of what is the interest of this project. Also, we have now two people with Alita and Sravani that are experts in VLBI observations, and they are part of all the groups. They work with the European VLBI group also. And we did some upgrades to the system thanks to one guy that I think is in this in the audience now, that is Harrow Bercoten, I think it is. So we upgraded the system that was really outdated, and now we are able to support better VLBI observations. So some of the interests of our people in that sense is the AGN emerging galaxies. Then there is this study that I have mentioned several times. I passed through in the rest of the talk, that is the interplanetary scintillations. So this kind of this technique is a technique when you study how the radio emission from sources that you have well calibrated and you know which detection you should have. To study how this is affected by the solar wind, for example. So when they when the light from a pulsar passes through a solar flare, it's affected. And you see these scintillations, and studying these radio sources, you are really studying the solar wind. This is of the interest of PK Manoharan, that is one of our senior guys and arrived 1 year ago to Puerto Rico. So the good thing with Arecibo is that due to the big sensitivity of our antenna, we can reach regions of this solar flare that are not reachable by any other installation in the globe. So we can go from 1 to 500 kilometers. And this is of a great interest for space weather. We also study the coronal mass ejections from the sun using the same technique. And that allows us studies of the ionized interstellar medium, of the solar wind plasma, but also on how it interacts with the Earth atmosphere. All of these are regions of areas of interest for our researchers at Arecibo. And if you have any interest on all of this, and you think that with data at other wavelength ranges, we can put everything together and have a deeper understanding, I'm here to hear you guys. So here, some of the works that our people has been publishing these years. So the study of pulsars, of course, that's a classic at Arecibo, and the pet project of one of our guys, of Ben Pereira, the one that he's feeding to grow, is the study of slow pulsars. So he is using observations at different telescopes, including Arecibo, so that he can cover different frequencies above 1.5 gigahertz from AO, below from the Nobel Observatory, and from the giant meter wave radio telescope in India. So he's studying these slow pulsars to detect flares and bursts. There is also another project, and this involves all of our team at Arecibo, but also one new postdoc at the Florida Space Institute that some of you may know, Raul Carballo. He's an astrophysicist, and he's working now for us with the Arecibo group. So led by Ben Pereira, this project is consists on drift scan observations of pulsars. It means that you stare at the sky and you observe the pulsars that pass in front of the telescope. And then collecting a row of data during 2, 3, 4, 5 days, you can start searching for pulsars, and you can look for radio bursts, and you can look for all the exotic things that happen there. The problem with this is that it's a bunch of data that you have. So one of our main goals also in support of the science group these years is to provide them with tools like applying machine learning techniques, like big data mining, like storing all this data in a modern system that is easy to access for us and for our users also. So that's another program that is running in parallel with the science, that is, we are building an office for big data there so that we can support these studies. And I would stay tuned if you are interested in this kind of things, because we hope to have a couple of publications before the end of the year. More radio astronomy. So let me walk you through these three works. They are kind of different, one of each other. The one on the left, that was published this year, 2020. I really like this one because it's one paper, but it's also a project in progress that grew at Arecibo. This Nipuni Palijaguru was one of these postdocs that was at Arecibo when we arrived. They were doing an outstanding job trying to support the whole radio astronomy program at Arecibo. You see, all that we are doing now with 6 people, they were only 2. But they did pretty well, and both postdocs moved now to different places, to different postdocs, but they are leveraging from the experience at Arecibo. So for example, this is this program that Nipuni has started. She's searching for the faintest fast radio burst, and she's doing that thanks to the Arecibo sensitivity. So, but as you know, if you look for the faintest thing, do not always find it. So in this paper, basically she has not detected this very faint fast radio burst, but this work is very good to put limits to the sensitivity that we have now, and it's very good to prepare for one new receiver that has been already funded by NSF and that is in development and that is going to be commissioning at Arecibo probably in 2022, I think. So it's called Alpaca, and it's a new receiver that is going to really improve the capacities that we have now. So that I like this because it shows the success of the success of people working at Arecibo in their career. You know, with postdocs, you don't always want to retain them. Sometimes it's good that they grow in different directions. So this second one, this is not led by AO, but it has participation of another of our postdocs, Alison Smith from the Radio Astronomy Group. And this is on this project of how the clouds pass from being formed by hydrogen atoms to be molecular clouds. So some observations also did at Arecibo were very good to put constraints to the models to how these molecules form, these clouds form. The third work, this is of this exotic magnetar discovered in the cone. Probably some of you know way better than myself what I'm talking about, but this was a very big explosion, a cosmic explosion, and it formed a magnetar. Not everything was known about that. There were a lot of studies, and part of them were included Arecibo data. So what apparently a magnetar is a neutron star with an extremely powerful magnetic field. And all of this is a very recent 2020 publication. Let's go to the next. Okay, so pulsars. I'm not going to explain to you what a pulsar is, you know, but what I want to highlight here is why they are really useful to detect gravitational waves. And it's because, you know, all of these, they are very, these pulsars are very rapidly rotating, but they are very stable and they can be used as atomic clocks. So if you establish a net of pulsars all around the universe around you, you can expect to detect the changes in the timing of these pulsars. And you need a very sensitive array that is able to time up to milliseconds. So Arecibo is one of the main components of NanoGraph, that is the EUSA net to observe this kind of pulsars and to establish this net of beacons, of voids that are going to move with the gravitational waves and are going to allow us to detect these gravitational waves. But this NanoGraph also works together with the European Pulsar Timing Array and the North American NanoHertz Observatory for Gravitational Waves and the Parkes Pulsar Timing Array. And this is, again, for if you want to be really sensitive, you need biggest arrays and longest arrays, and you need to work in collaboration. So we have published one of these nets of pulsars, Ben Pereira, our junior scientist. He published it in 2019, and there are more publications to come in the next months based on Arecibo data. And this is all for radio astronomy. If you don't have any questions, we can go with the next. I'm waiting. No, okay.
Noemi, just pay attention to the time. That is.
Okay, so let's go with this. Mm-hmm. I call the space and atmospheric sciences area, I call it que tengo de todo. And you will see why I call it like that. So this is what this group gives to me every time that I tell you, how do you introduce your group? And they give me this that looks so complicated, and it really is. But I still show it because it shows the power of all the things that are installed in Arecibo for the study of the atmosphere. So here on the left, you can see the different regions of the atmosphere, and you can see how the different variables as temperature and density of neutrons and everything, how they change. They have different profiles at the different regions. To really study in depth all of this, including the ionosphere, including how the ionosphere interacts with the sun, you need to go for different measures in density and temperature, and for that with different instrumentation, active optics, passive optics, radar, and radio receivers. So all of this instrumentation here on the bottom is available at Arecibo, and they can observe from the neutral density of the atmosphere, plasma density, electron temperature, plasma flow, air glow, all of this. Okay, so this is complex, but it's what I call que es lo que tienes, tengo de todo. And this is another display of the same thing. So you can see here the cherry pick of this, the main thing is the radar, is the antenna gain, is the great sensitivity, but around this, we run the HF facility that is able to transform the ionosphere to cause very short but artificial auroras, thanks to these dipoles that are here that emit and they emit to the primary reflects it to the main antenna, and then it's sent back to the space. And so this is for the radar. And then we can see here that it's not only Arecibo that is working with the HF, with the detection of the incoherent scattered radar or with the optical lens. We have also one installation in Isla Culebra here on the left. This small island there that, is another place where we have instrumentation. We have one trailer there and we are installing another. And some of the instruments that we have at Arecibo are also installed at Isla Culebra. Of course, not for the big sensitivity antenna, but for rheometers, all sky detectors, radiometers, these kind of things. And this is really good because if you observe the same thing from two different points, you have this three-dimensional component that allows you to study phenomena in height. Some of the highlights for SAS, this complicated display here shows that through these HF experiments where we emit and transform the ionosphere, we were able to create a cavity on the plasma, like a bubble. So we are transforming it. And this is very important, for example, for communications. I know that the Department of State is really interested in this kind of experiments, but I don't know anything else because I cannot, because it's the Department of State. So this is all that I can say. And also, if we run this experiment simultaneously to experiments done with optical instruments, we can see how, if these alterations in the ionosphere propagate to the lower layers of the atmosphere. Okay, this here on the left, on the right, on my right, this is the logo for the remote optical facility in Isla Culebra, and this is one result that we had this year, and really shows how some kind of this medium scale disturbances in the ionosphere, they this is not a study with HF, these are natural affections of the ionosphere disturbances, and they propagate so that we can observe them in the visible, and not in the visible, with other instrumentation, with radiometers and other instrumentations. And we can call it a long change of data, analyzing them more than 630 nights. We have discovered how these perturbations vary seasonally. And also, if they are influenced by the hurricane season, for example. So this has been published this year and has been interesting results of how all of this varies with time. This is another paper published this year, right, Sada told, but also a project in progress because it needs more data. So these LIDARs that we use that can observe the mesosphere and the thermosphere using the calcium ion, but also we can observe sodium. Another one that I don't remember now, but was in the other slide. So what we observe with this, we are observing the atmosphere, but what we are really observing in this case with these experiments is the rests from the disintegration of the meteoroids. So we observe the meteor zone that is between 80 to 120 kilometers where the meteors are disintegrate. And with the sensitivity of our instrumentation, we could go higher to the F region where this density is really lower. It's like only 10% only 2% of the material from the asteroids is deposited in this region. And we were sensitive enough to detect it. So we can see if it correlates with the density on those layers, correlates with the density at the lower layers and what is happening for the transport of these materials and everything. This is a project for the future. This is a project funded, led by one of our researchers at the SAS group. And it's called Carla. It's going to be installed in both in Arecibo, where we are close to finish the installation there in 2020. And in 2021, it's going to be installed in Culebra, and it allows to study the aerosols. And so, believe it or not, in Puerto Rico, we have waves of the Sahara dust, the calimas that really affect the Canaries. For those of you that have observed there, they also reach Puerto Rico. And you know, when you have lived in the Canaries, you almost don't feel the one in Puerto Rico, but they really feel it. They are always worried about this. And actually, you can see it in these two photos here. This is the same area, but covered in a day with a calima and in a day with calima. They don't call it calima. They are Sahara dust. So this LIDAR that is going to be installed in both places is going to study these aerosols. And the good thing of going to Culebra to study this is that you can study really the first place where it hit is after crossing the Atlantic. So it's not going to be affected by the pollution at the metropolitan area of San Juan in Puerto Rico that is really huge. Just I'm going to leave you with this because I'm not going to go in detail because I know you're going to ask me probably, but this is what happened in August. This is 2020 taking exponentially. We had an accident at Arecibo. One of the cables that you can see here on the lowest part broke. One of the ones that support the platform, it broke. It detached from the place closest to the platform. It hit the dome and it hit the antenna. And it broke several panels there. So at this point, Arecibo from August is closed, is no operational. Because we are still secure, well, we have been able to secure the platform, but we are still studying what really happened with that cable. We were able to take it out of the shack there, take it to the NASA Kennedy Space Center to diagnose it and do the forensic work. So, these are the four stages that we are doing, and these are some of the, we have been able to form a group with the best engineering components in the world that are working with us through this, and we are working with the NSF to draw a timeline that allows us to repair this cable and to secure that no other cable is going to suffer the same hip cut, you know. So this is, on the right, you can see how the performance of Arecibo has improved in the last 2 years. And here on the left, you can see some of the projects that are active at this point and open for the future. And that's all. I'm going to cut it here because I really want to hear you and not to hear myself anymore.
Thank you very much, Noemi, for this nice talk. And then the talk is open for questions. Please raise your hand if you want to ask something to Noemi. Okay, Lourdes, yes.
Hello. Hi, Noemi.
Hello, Lourdes.
How are you? Trying to see you. Okay, I'm seeing René. Okay. thank you very much for this all this work and the nice talk. Oh, sorry, I didn't have my camera.
I can see you now.
Okay, sorry about this. Yes, I wanted to thank you for this nice talk about this Arecibo, who is in the very heart of radio astronomers, and all the work you are doing now on that. I have a comment, and is that. Because of that, I missed H1 science in the history of Arecibo. I think it has been a very important ingredient in the science. I think especially alfalfa survey mm-hmm. has produced probably, if one wants to measure science in in papers, about 1,000 papers, I think this year about 100 papers, and is Arecibo, well, now we have FAST, and that's part of like, my question, that is going to be part of my question, but having a high resolution in H1 with single dish as the one provided by Arecibo, such a long wavelength as 21 centimeters is very difficult. So Arecibo has been these years a key tool for H1 astronomy. So I kind of missed that a bit because probably you had to talk about many things, but I didn't want to to miss that point. And then I was wondering, how do you compare the kind of the niche for Arecibo with respect to FAST radio telescope?
So respect to H1, I kind of mentioned it slightly because it's the interest of two of our scientists there. Alison Smith is really interested in that, and I know that Anish is also very interested in that. Anish is the head, Anish Rossi is the head of the group. Actually, Anish is interested in everything, and that's a lack for us. But really, Alfalfa, yeah, we published a couple of web posts this year in our newsletter. If you are not subscribed, subscribe to our newsletter, let me know, because we have been publishing still things with discoveries with Alfalfa. And we had this awards also that Martha Hines is the name that she received this year also because of all the work that she has been doing in H1 and with Arecibo and everything. So we know how important it is. I am not the expert here, but I think that Alpaca, have you heard of Alpaca? Alpaca is going to cover part of the science also. It's one of the new receivers that is being developed at this moment. And I've heard that it's going to be revolutionary for different fields in Arecibo. So probably keep an eye on that. You can, if there is anything you want to do with Arecibo and you think we still can do, you are all welcome to submit proposals. And even if there is something that you want that is exploratory, we have, not now because we are closed, but typically we have a lot of director time that we can use to do this kind of exploratory research, like, okay, we never tried this before because the time was very competitive, but we would like to try it and to see if we can open a different line of research now. So that's it.
My question about FAST was not about H1, but in general, the niche of Arecibo with respect to,
FAST.
How does it compare in the things you have said?
So the first thing to compare with, that's not the main thing now. The main thing before to compare was that Arecibo is open, FAST is still not working, not 100% operative. Now we cannot say that because of the accident in August. But I guess that they cover different wavelength ranges, and always, for my experience in visible and near infrared, when you observe something, you want to cover as much of the wavelengths as you can so that you really understand all the physics that is going on. So that is one thing that I think is more a collaborative approach than a competitive approach that we have to take. Of course, for planetary, it does not compare at all because we have radar capacity and FAST doesn't have it. So that's also another important thing for Arecibo. But I really think that we have to find ways to collaborate with FAST for radio astronomy, because radio astronomy has been the treasure trove for Arecibo. And we want to keep it at that level.
Thank you, Lourdes. There is another question. Julia?
Hi. Hi, everybody. Hi, Noemi. Good to see you. Considering the accident and everything, do you have like a realistic expected date to resume operations?
Well, we don't have it because we don't, the situation is complicated because we have one failure in one cable, but it was totally unexpected. So we are very careful in doing the diagnostic, because we really want to see if this same thing could reproduce in the others. We don't know, we had a very heavy season of earthquakes from December last year. We don't know if that was affecting. When this happened, we had just passed a tropical storm. We don't know if that had affected. or it's just there are also some indications that it could be just fatigue from bad installation in the beginning. We don't know. So these months from August, September have been to secure the platform to be able to, because it's this 900 tons that are hanging there, to remove the rest of the cable. We had to go there, and you cannot do that if it's not safe. So that has been all very slow. Then, now that we have the piece, we can diagnose. And then we have to design how we are going to solve that, how we are going to substitute the cable, and how many of them we have to substitute, or maybe none. All of that can go from 2 months to, I don't know, 1 year, 1.5 year, I don't know. So, and I don't know, because we are very careful in not jumping up to conclusions. We have to wait. We are in a process where we really have to wait for the next step. Also, we need budget to do all these things that are unexpected. And that is something that we have to work with NSF. So we really have to go through the steps. Okay, we can take this bag of money that we had to do the repairs from the hurricane, for example, to do this thing now. But as soon as we finish, if this is the way that we're going to go ahead, we are going to need this much. And those are things that we are going to have to work with them in collaboration. And with NASA also, because it's one of them, the most interested in Arecibo.
Is so, the current COVID situation also delaying this, all these checks? How is this affecting?
At this moment, no, but it affected us a lot this summer. Fortunately, when this happened, we were already allowed, because Arecibo did a very strong lockdown. They were confined, even with low numbers, they were totally confined. So we couldn't even go to the telescope. Fortunately, when this passed, it was already opening and we could do that. So at this moment it's not affected, but the situation in Arecibo with the COVID, it has peaks. So we don't know when, if at some point is going to make us go back, you know, to or send us home again.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Julia. Other question for Noemi? I have a short one. You mentioned at the beginning that you can something like buy time for particular projects. Mm-hmm. Can you say a number for an hour of observation or something like this?
No, because it really depends on the experiment that you want to do.
Okay.
If you want to run radar, you really have to use the clusters that we have and the transmitter to emit the signal and to collect it and everything. So that has a price. If you want to do HF, it's more expensive because there is a huge building with cabinets that to generate all the energy that you need to alter the atmosphere. If you would like to do regular backscattering observations of the incoherent backscatter, those probably would be cheaper.
Okay.
But there is a web page that I can send to you after this, if you want, where you can really see all of that separated, and you can see how much it would take, 1 hour, 2 hours,
okay,
of each of the experiments.
Okay, any other questions for Noemi?
Also, now that I mentioned the pay to observe webpage, there is a webpage also with a timeline for all the repairs and all the information. As soon as we do some advances, we publish an update there. So that also can be accessed, actually, I think.
Okay, you can send to me and I will include in the comments of the video.
Here you can see it.
On the YouTube. Mm-hmm. Okay. If there is no more questions for Noemi, I want to thank again Noemi. Apologize from Isabel that she needs to go. And thanks again for accepting this talk for the Severo Ochoa program, this colloquium talk. And we will manage to upload this video in YouTube and circulate the link. Yes. Thank you very much, Noemi.
Okay, thanks to you all for inviting me, for attending, and don't hesitate to contact me if you have any curiosity or any interest on Arecibo.
Perfect.